Mason in Ireland show. Ben Lyons is in for John. Adonal Foyle, former NBA great.
10 years with the Warriors, huh?
10 years. I should have like had that moment now, right?
I know. I was about to say. I feel like they've won as many games this year as they did the 10 years.
You got there a little too early.
Thanks a lot. Bring it back.
We will let you know and continue to keep you updated at the Inland Regional Center in San Bernardino, California. There has been an active shooter situation. There are as many as 20 victims there, as many as 12 fatalities. And those suspects, according to multiple sources, Fox, CNN, those suspects fled in a black SUV. So if you are in San Bernardino, if you're in Riverside, if you're in the surrounding areas, you certainly want to stay inside because these guys are wearing, according to, again, multiple sources, tactical gear, body armor. They are weaponized. There are also reports, and we believe this to be true now because of the multitude of reports, that there's a explosive device on the second floor of the Inland Regional Center in San Bernardino. Fox News reporting that there's going to be a robotic device that goes in and detonates that bomb if it is in fact a bomb. We don't know certainly that that's the case. 670 people work at the Inland Regional Center. They provide services to more than 30,000 Southern Californians with developmental disabilities. That is their focus. The area around the center is essentially, it looks like a war zone. I mean, FBI, ATF, local police,
first responders,
they are there en masse. And it is, I just have, you know, a guy named, and this is, you know, you think about this as a parent, a guy named Terry Perry is outside the Inland Regional Center. This was as of 3:37 Pacific, so this is actually right now. He's outside the Regional Center. He's received text messages from his daughter, who he is yet to be in touch with. She sent one text that said, "Shooting at my work, people shot." The next text he got, "Pray for us, I am locked in an office." He still doesn't have contact with his daughter, who, at least according to this report, as of 12 minutes ago, she's there.
Adonal, when you were playing in the league, obviously,
and I should say, Adonal Foyle
was here with us today, and you know, when you were playing in the league, and something of this kind of magnitude happened throughout your career, whether it was a Columbine shooting, which I believe happened during the season, or something of great tragedy of this level, what do you do as an athlete? How, because the Lakers are playing a game tonight, and if I'm a Laker who has connections to Southern California, the last thing I want to do is look over a scouting report or a game.
And we should say they're in Washington.
Yeah, they're in Washington, so I would imagine there will be a moment of silence tonight. This is going to be a story people across the world are going to be talking about. How does that affect you as a professional athlete to go about your job? It kind of puts things in perspective.
Yeah, you know, I think the first thing that must be said is that, you know, our hearts go out to all the families that is a part of this terrible tragedy. And I think the most important thing that I always wanted people to know is that athletes are an extension of everything that goes on. We tend to think of athletes outside of the sphere. Maybe they don't get involved in a lot of political stuff, but they all are very aware of what's going on. And they take that load with them. They take that burden with them into the game. And I remember, you know, part of like the you have this dichotomy of saying, okay, I want to grieve, I want to moan, but at the same time, people need escape. They need to have that business as usual, and we're entertaining, and our job is to perform and, you know, to keep people distracted for at least in that moment and give them some respite from what's happening. So, but we carry that with us. I remember, you know, there are players whose parents die, whose family member die, and you have to find a way to go up, and as they say, you know, on Broadway, the show must go on. You have to find a way to do that, and it's not always very easy. You know, you crash, you find moments where you just crash, and you know, I remember my second year, I lost my grandmother. I wasn't able to go back home. You know, she raised me, and we were down to about, I think, 7-8 players. So if I went back home, we were gonna forfeit a game. So I had to, you know, decide not to see my grandmother to be there for the team. So you do make those decisions, you know, throughout your career. I mean, we have a very long season with 6 months. It's not like it's like a weekend game. You know, we play 6 months, we play 82 plus games. Yeah. So it's very difficult, but I will say this, that every player, when you go into the locker room, they carry those things. Did you hear about this? Do you have any family? I mean, the first thing I did when the Paris situation happened is I called Mikhail Petris, one of my teammates, and I said, is your family okay? Do you have anybody in that area? And, you know, he's like, thank you, you know, we're okay. I check in with everybody. So we all have that common humanity, and being an athlete doesn't shield us from that.
You know, it seems as though, you know, we've talked on the show a lot about the days of Muhammad Ali. And Muhammad Ali is a conscientious objector, opposed the Vietnam War. He became, you know, a huge villain to a lot of people. And now we all feel as though Ali was a guy who stood up for his values and, you know, was heroic. I think most of us do. Since then, there's a, you know, I've since found out this is an apocryphal story. When Michael Jordan was asked to endorse a Democrat in the North Carolina Senate race versus Jesse Helms, Michael Jordan, and again, I believe this now to be apocryphal, but it says something, that Michael Jordan said he wouldn't endorse a Democrat because Republicans buy shoes too. But we've entered sort of this new era where athletes seem less afraid to express themselves. I mean, in after the Ferguson shooting of Michael Brown, there were four Los Angeles Rams who came out with the hands up. I agree or disagree. This is just examples.
We live in a far more transparent society now, and I think in the 80s and 90s when Jordan played, there was this kind of separation between who an athlete actually was and who they, you know, wanted, how they wanted to present themselves. There was kind of a buffer there. Now there's a transparency that exists, and I think athletes, to their credit, have embraced that.
Yeah.
You see LeBron is very active in
LeBron and Dwayne Wade and Chris Bosh after the Trayvon Martin shooting came out in hoodies. They sent that out on Twitter. So athletes seem less afraid to express themselves. And to me, at least, whether you agree or disagree, that's a positive step in the world.
Yeah, I think that we have to, the mechanism that is in place now, social media, give players an absolutely total control of their message. When you're trying to figure out how to send a message, you want to send it in the right way. And sometimes how the media interpret those messages and how they interpret an image could be, is out of your control somewhat. And I think as kind of the advent of social media, which could be both a double-edged sword, but it has clearly given athletes an opportunity to express themselves in any way they want to. As I said, that could be both good and bad. But I think that's one of the mechanisms that has happened over time. And players are feeling more and more connected with the fans they have. They're seeing what the response of people in the community are instantaneously, and then they're able to craft message or able to act, you know, as if they are ambassadors for those communities. So I think in many ways, technology give them an opportunity to express themselves. And I think that you've seen players that are more morally willing to take chances at the expense of endorsing, because they're saying, you know, look, there are certain things that are more important than, you know, how much extra money I make in a contract.
You were the head of the Players Association you were involved with?
I was, the first vice president.
Yeah. So you worked closely, obviously, with the guys around the league and found out firsthand that, you know, many of them were passionate about these things beyond, obviously, the game.
Oh, yeah. I mean, one of the areas is that, you know, we don't give enough credit, but most of the players in the league all have some kind of charity arm mm-hmm. that does amazing work, not just here, but you know, across the world. We have about 125 international players now, and they all do things all over the world. So we are beginning to have a really broad reach, and I think with the understanding of the globalization of the game, you see players are saying, we can make a difference in the world. We can make a difference in our community, in our communities across the country. And it is our moral responsibility to do that. And that is very refreshing.
You know, I also wonder if you're listening to KSP in Los Angeles. I also wonder if there wasn't a sort of a flashpoint for this activism on the part of athletes in the last couple of years, which was the Donald Sterling situation here in Los Angeles. I think that was probably, for a lot of guys, the first time they spoke up about something, and obviously entirely justified. But I wonder if it almost opened the door for athletes to express themselves in a more open way.
Well, I think it's leverage and power and understanding how to use that power. It tends to take people a long time to understand that they have profound impact in our society, whether you like it or not, by virtue of being in this small cast of the most extraordinary athletes in the world. It gives you a certain amount of power, but it hasn't been always clear how to utilize that power. And you can see now that kids in college is understanding that, you know, university has a lot of money on the line when it comes to they taking a social position. If they do it right and they leverage it, they can have an impact. And I think also with this is that the players are saying, you know, we are making tremendous amount of money for these teams, and the least you can do is to treat me like a human being. The least you can do is that they have some standard that we think that we're entitled to. So I think that part of that is like seeing the revenue stream, seeing what's happening, understanding the business aspect of the game, and to see themselves not just as athletes. I mean, I think sports represent that unique space where athletes are both the labor and they're the product. Very, very few spaces where, you know, Apple has a phone. But in professional sports, the athlete is both the labor and the product. You're selling them, and you're selling, you know, they're also the representative of that labor. So I think they're understanding how to leverage that power a lot more. And I think because they're talking to each other a lot more because of the mechanism, social media, and all the opportunities they have to talk to each other.
A couple of things I want to mention again about the active shooter situation in San Bernardino. The sheriff's department there asking anyone with any information about who these guys are to call 1-800-78-CRIME, 1-800-78-CRIME. We believe now that Fox News reporting suspects may have left the scene in a black SUV. That's also being reported by CNN. There are 1 to 3 suspects, still not confirmed how many suspects were involved in this shooting. As many as 20 were shot, as many as 12 fatalities. SWAT teams are now working to clear the building, and it is, you know, quite literally a war zone. We're looking at people, we're keeping an eye on television here, and on this is on Fox 11. We're looking at people exiting the building with their hands up as a way to indicate that they are, you know, that they're victims. They're not obviously involved in the incident. There's an explosive device reportedly on the second floor of this building at the Inland Regional Center, and Fox News, CNN both reporting that that will be detonated in some way. Fox News says it will be detonated with a robotic device. At this point, again, keeping an eye on the scene, we've not seen any explosion, any detonation of anything, so we don't exactly know where that stands at this moment, but we're going to make sure you know. Actually, it's a very good day for Adonal Foyle, who's got real political consciousness and social consciousness, to be here right now with us. You come from, we talked about this a little bit off the air, you come from the Grenadines. Mm-hmm. What are guns like on the Grenadines? Like, is there anything comparable that could happen there?
Most people, I mean, gun is a very expensive proposition. I mean, you know, when you have a developing country where standard of living is very low, buying a gun could mean buying, you know, food for months and months and months. A gun becomes, you know, very, very expensive. Suddenly we have violence as any place in the world. But they're very rare and far between. You know, most of the people, when I grew up on my island, most of the people that, you know, that die would be die of natural causes. But we've had accidents, we have different kind of stuff. But I do think that, you know, we see gun in a much different way than they do in the United States. And I'm sure that's true for many places across the globe.
In addition to, you know, some of these political issues and things we're talking about today, you've been very outspoken about the money that athletes make and how to best manage it and handle it, and you've given a lot of advice to younger players about what to do with their money. Did you, being from an impoverished country, did you struggle with the fact that you made a lot of money and then had this responsibility to improve the lives of the people? Is that something you kind of wrestle with?
I was absolutely, for me, I've always felt like I grew up with, when you come from such a small area, you kind of know the people that you go to school with very intimately. And I tell people all the time is that I know for a fact that I was not the smartest. I know for a fact that I was not the third or fourth or fifth. Because I remember, you know, I used to do homework with a lot of those kids, and I know that they were much smarter than I was. So given the opportunity because of my basketball skills to get off the island and really get an opportunity to go to college, which the majority of the kids, 90, 95% of the kids in my class would not have that opportunity.
And you went to a good school, you went to Colgate.
I went to Colgate, and it was part of it was because of my extraordinary basketball talent, but it certainly, I didn't think it was because I was the smartest person to come off the island. When you kind of walk away from that, you carry that burden of saying, I owe it to all those kids I left behind to be better, to really take advantage of the opportunity that was given to me. So when I got into the league, I always see this as it's very fleeting. What you have in your brain is what you're going to have in your brain for the rest of your life. You can keep increasing that capacity. But knowledge represents for me the kind of the golden grail. I wanted to get to that point. I wanted to be an educated person. I wanted to really use the opportunity that I have to make a path for the kids that I left behind and to make a path for kids who don't have the opportunity because of the basketball or extraordinary athletic skills.
Regular programming suspended at this moment here at ESPN LA. We will have Lakers basketball for you tonight. Lakers at Washington. A. Martinez, who is also a host of Take Two on KPCC. He also hosts our Lakers pregame. He will join us in a little while as well. Adonal Foyle is here. Ben Lyons is in for John. Some confusion now at that scene at the Inland Regional Center. The CBC say that gunmen are barricaded at that building. Fox 11 says shooters may have left in a black SUV. Actually, multiple sources say that. What we do know as of right now is that 1 to 3 suspects are still loose in some way, whether it's barricaded in that building or off in an SUV. They are wearing tactical gear. There are as many as 20 people shot. SWAT teams are working to clear the building, and the LAPD is now asking that anyone with information on the shooting in San Bernardino, the incident there, and would like to remain anonymous. This is important. If you would like to remain anonymous and you have information, you can call 1-800-78-CRIME, 1-800-78-CRIME. Mason in Ireland, this is ESPN Live.